Hey, thank you. Hello, everyone. I'm glad to be presenting here today. My name is Alice, and I am a PhD candidate at McGill University in Canada. And today I will talk a little bit about my research entitled Designing Ultra-Conserved Elements, UCEs, Probesets for Lace Wings and Allies. For my PhD, I am exploring the origin and diversification of freshwater insects. They are those insects that depend on freshwater in at least one stage of their life cycle. Here we have an example of a caddisfly, which have eggs, larvae, and pupae living in water while the adult is a flying stage. Also, we have a few photos of freshwater insects because they are very beautiful. So for my research project, I am using Osmiloidea as my model because they have both terrestrial and freshwater representatives. Here we have some photos of the families within Osmiloidea. The first one is the Spongiflora cichlid, a freshwater family that are parasites of freshwater sponges. They have these needle-like mouth parts when larvae, which they insert in the freshwater spongy and feed on the cellular content. The second one is the lace wings osmilid. They are terrestrial and semi-aquatic insects. They are found near moist area, near rivers, but they can also be found very far from a water body, and they are generalist predators. The last one is the dragon lace wings, Nevrotid, which is also aquatic and during all larval, all immature stages, and they are also generalist predators. They live in cold, clean water, and they are very sensitive to change in water. This superfamily is member of the superorder Neuropterida. Neuropterida is composed by three orders, Haphingioptera, Megaloptera, and Neuroptera. And several hypotheses for the evolution of Neuropterida have been proposed using both morphological and molecular data. But even the placement of Osmiloidea within the lace wings tree of life has still been discussed. So recently, phylogenomic studies recovered these three families sharing a common ancestor, but these studies recovered ambiguous results for the origin of the group, if it was terrestrial or if it was aquatic, probably because of limited taxon sampling. And in order to investigate Osmiloidea origin and diversification, I needed to first reconstruct their phylogenetic tree. We know nothing about the relationship of Osmiloidea species nor the evolution of traits of this group. And to solve this issue, I will apply the target enrichment of ultra-conserved element. UCE has never been used to understand the evolution of Neuropterida, and it can bring new insights of how this group evolved. UCE are these highly conserved regions across distant related taxa and can be used to investigate phylogenetic relationship of both shallow and deep taxonomic level, meaning young and old lineages. In this graph here, we can see like the UCE core, which are these highly conserved regions. And these other areas here are called flanking areas. They are more variable than the core. Additionally, because of the development of UCEs, we can get information of old specimens from museum, genetic information of old specimens from museum, pinnate insects or set insects in alcohol, but are more than 100 years old. And this is important for the growing field of museomics, which is the use of specimens from museums in genomic studies. And considering as biodiversity is under threat, museums are a crucial baseline for studying biodiversity. Here in this graph, we can see that even specimens that are 100 years old or more, was it still possible to recover UCU loci from these specimens? As I mentioned before, UCE is part of the target enrichment method, meaning that we will capture only regions of interest from the genome. And to do that, we need probe sets. Probe sets are a group of smaller sequences used to target and capture UCEs. They are analogous to primers in Sanger sequences. And in this image here, just to illustrate the how to design these probes and to show how they more or less look like. So the thing is that lace wings, they do not have probe sets designed for them. And if I want to reconstruct their phylogenetic trees using UCE in my analysis, I first needed to design the probe set. So my goal is to design a neuropteridae-specific probe to target UCE with the hypothesis that this will better target lace wings UCE loci and will allow me to reconstruct the evolutionary history of Osmiloidea more precisely. In order to create these probes, I used the Filucci workflow. And this is a user-friendly bioinformatic tool that helps using UCEs for very different analysis. So I downloaded Neuropteridae genome sequences available in the National Center for Biotechnology Information and followed the tutorial 4 of Filucci to create these probes. And here we have a step-by-step of how to design probes. I will briefly mention them, highlighting some important steps. The first thing we need to do is to select the base genome, this gray line here. It's also called reference genome, which is crucial to design probes because all other sequences will be aligned based on this reference genome and it changes the final number of loci recovered. So it's important to choose an appropriate base genome sequences. After choosing this base genome, we will align all the other sequences to this base genome, and we will remove shorter alignments, having these longer alignments to align it to the base genome. After that, we will highlight these shared overlapping regions so we can have this UCE sequences that we want to target. And using these marked regions, we will design a matching probes, temporary matching probes that we will compare with the other genome sequences and create the final probe sets. After designing the probe set, I will check the performance of these newly designed probes compared to available probes to other insect orders to see if the one that I created will have a better performance targeting UCEs of lace wings. And then I will use these probes to target UCE loci and use it for sequencing and reconstructive phylogenetic tree. So now let's talk about the results. There are 3 Neuropteridae genomes available in the NCBI database. 2 of the green lace wings and 1 Dobson fly. And I used these 3 genomes to design the probe sets and tried to reduce the stringency of the analysis so it could also work for the snake flies because there are no genomes available of snake flies. So it can complicate the design of the probes for this order. In order to include it in the analysis, I reduced the stringency during the when I was following the workflow. So I run the analysis several times, changing the base genome in order to test which genome would perform better as the base genome. And at the end, the Neoneuromus ignobilis, the Dobson fly species, was able to recover a higher number of UCE loci, about with close of 3,000 loci recovered. So this was the species that I chose to continue the workflow. And as a result, I continued the process and I recovered, I created, I designed about 23,000 UCE loci. 23,000 probes targeting almost 3,000 UCE loci, as we can see here in these two boxes. After that, we can, if necessary, I can filter these probes to reduce the number in, and make the analysis faster. And I can remove replicated probes, remove shorter sequences, and also subset these probes to specific groups. So for example, if I would like to work with a specific genus within the order, I can subset my probes to use in this specific genus, still keeping the homology of the group. And to conclude, we designed the first probe set for Neuropterida, allowing us to access a new data set to investigate the evolutionary history of this group, which is which has been discussed for a really long time now. And for my future steps, I am in the process of testing these newly designed probes in silico, meaning using bioinformatic tools to check the performance of the probes using anchored hybrid elements and transcriptomes. After that, I will be able to identify parameters for optimization. So maybe increase the number of loci recovered, test in vitro. So sending these probes together with DNA extractions for sequencing. And when I have the sequence, I will be able to reconstruct the phylogenetic tree and check ancestral character states and historical biogeography of Osmiloidea. And with that, I finish my presentation. So I would like to thank you all for listening to me and my labs for helping me with this help and support, the funding agencies and all the collaborators and researchers in this project. Thank you.
Wonderful talk. Now, if anyone has any questions for our first speaker, I invite you to use the raise hand reaction, and I will invite you to unmute so that you can ask your question in person. If you're feeling a little bit shy, you are also certainly welcome to put your question in the chat for Alice to answer. All right, well, we will go ahead and start the change over to the next, or to our second speaker. Thank you so much, Alex. Yeah. All right, Rami, do you wanna try and get your screen share up? Perfect, looks wonderful. Right, and I will let you know when you're able to start. It'll just be a second here. All right, you can go ahead and get started.
Okay. So, hello everyone. My name is Romy Vanessa Parra, and today I want to share with you the latest discoveries in ambient gymnophthalmids. I consider that as important as the work you do is where you come from, because this shapes your way of thinking and gives you a different perspective. And I'm telling you this because I was born in Ecuador, one of the most biodiverse countries in the world, and the second one in South America. And this definitely motivated me to study and protect all this biodiversity. So as I already said, Ecuador is a mega diverse country, and this is especially true for lizards. We have around 200 species of lizards, and a lot of these species have been described during the last years. So here you can see in this histogram the number of species of reptiles that have been described each 10 years. And you can see that there are three important peaks. One of the highest peaks is in 1000, it is around 1080-60. That was when a lot of naturalists were collecting and describing species of reptiles from Ecuador. But then we can see a second important peak that is in the last decade. And this decade is the second most productive in number of reptile species described. And during these years, so many species has been the focus of a study, such as the case of Gymnophthalmidae. Gymnophthalmidae is a family, is a real diverse family in the American tropics. It has around 300 species nested in six subfamilies. And the family is endemic to Central and South America. And some studies have found that the time when several species of lizard start to diversify match with the origin of the uplift of the Andes, and other studies have found or suggest that high altitudes are correlated with high levels of species endemism. Therefore, we can conclude that the uplift of the Andes played an important role in the diversification of gymnophthalmid lizards. So in this slide, you can see the great morphological and ecological diversity of the family. Here we have five different species that displayed a different morphology and also ecological habits. So for example, we have the case of Calyptomatus cinebatrachius, that is a species that is fossorial. And on the other hand, we have the example of Neusticurus, that is a semi-aquatic species. And the family in general is really diverse, has a great morphological variation. If you are a herpetologist, maybe you can see that you can find the same phenotypes in completely different clades that are not related at all. So working with Gymnophthalmidae, it's great because this could be a great model to study convergent evolution. But today I'm going to focus my talk on the subfamily Cercosaurinae, that is the less known subfamily in this big family Gymnophthalmidae, but is the one that has around the 50% of the species of gymnophthalmid lizards. So the subfamily Cercosaurinae has around 20 genera, and in Ecuador we have 11 genera of these 20 genera. But today I'm going to focus my talk in two parts. The first part is going to be about the genus Polydabulus, and the second part is going to be about the genus Selvasaur. Polydabulus genus was first described by Peters in 1862. Polydabulus lizards are a small terrestrial lizard, oviparous, that have flat and elongate bodies, not colorful. And Polydabulus lizards are among the most prominent gymnophthalmids in the northern Andes. And the genus is restricted to Colombia, Ecuador, and Peru. So currently we have 18 species in the genus Polydabulus, and three of these 18 species were described just this year. So this suggests that more discoveries can be made in a genus that has a rather a cryptic morphology. So when I did my thesis undergrad, I worked on this species that is Polydabulus macbridii. And I worked on this species because in the latest and most complete phylogeny, this species was paraphyletic, and some specimens in this species were challenging to identify. And when I was doing my undergrad, I had the opportunity to be part of an important project in Ecuador that was named NOAA's ARC. So the main goal of this project was to characterize the biodiversity of Ecuador. And to do this, we did explorations to remote areas in Ecuador, such as the Condor Mountains that are located in the southern part of Ecuador. This place is really interesting because a lot of species of mammals, reptiles, plants, amphibians have been described from this area, and also they are related or they are similar to the tepuis in Venezuela. So after all these expeditions, we found that some specimens couldn't be assigned to the species that had been described until that days. So then we work in the formal description of four new species of Pholidobulus. So to do this work, we combine molecular data and also morphological data to support the recognition of these four new species. So here we have the phylogeny of Pholidobulus. Is a maximum clade credibility tree obtained of a partition analysis of mitochondrial and nuclear genes. And the phylogeny supports the monophyly of the genus and also supports the monophyly of the four new species. Even more, the phylogeny split the Pholidobulus magridi species into six different clades, and this is consistent with the last study that we saw in previous slides. We named all these clades and all the new species as the Pholidobulus magridi species complex. In addition to the molecular data, we also take into account morphological data. So we took measurements, we count different scales. We did this because the new species were similar and also sister clades of Pholidobulus magridi species. And we tried to assess degree of morphological differentiation among them using a PCA. So this PCA was based in 16 morphological characters. The most important components are correlated with number of scales. And in general, what we can see is that there is a wide overlap in the Pholidobulus magridi species, that is this big blue polygon. However, three of the four new species are clearly different from the Pholidobulus magridi species complex. And also we think that we found these results because in general, Pholidobulus genus has a cryptic morphology and some traits are challenging to do species delimitation. In addition to this, we prepare the hemipenes of the four new species. So the hemipenes are the sexual organs of males, snakes, and lizards. Hemipenes have been useful in taxonomic studies. And in general, what we found is that the hemipenes are bilobed. So they have two lobes that are separated by the sulcus spermaticus. And also we can find some difference between the species. So for example, we found that Pholidobulus samec and Pholidobulus fascinatus, the hemipenes have a conical shape that here the basis is thinner than the rest of the body, whereas Pholidobulus condor and Dolichoderis has a cylindrical shape. So the conclusion of this first part is that the recognition of our new species these different clades of Pholidobulus magridi suggests that the diversity of the genus Pholidobulus is greater than we previously thought. For future studies, we recommend to include more data, such as larger samples or genomic data or environmental or ecological data that might be useful to do a species delimitation in this taxa and other taxa. So now we're moving to the second genus, that is Selvasaura. And a common problem in the subfamily Cercosaurine and in general in gymnophthalmid lizard is that some clades remain poorly known and need formal description. So in this study that was published in 2016, the authors resolved most of the relationships in Cercosaurine, but they also found some lineages that couldn't be assigned to any of the genus that were described until that day. Years after this study, UC1 was described as a new genus that was named Euspondylus, and in 2018, UC3 was described as a new genus that was named Selvasaura. And in 2021, we did the first description of the genus Selvasaura from the Amazonian Ecuador, and this was the first record of this genus in Ecuador Amazon. And to do this work, we proceed in the same way as with Pholidobulus. We collect molecular data and also morphological data. And in this slide, you can see the new species of Selvasaura from Ecuador. So the species are identifiable because they have a prominent vertebral strip and all the species have red eyes. Something interesting about the species is that we found that they can have semi-arboreal ecological habits, because a lot of specimens were found resting on leaves at 1 meter above the ground. But we need more data to support this hypothesis. So here you can see the maximum likelihood tree of Selvasaura that was obtained under a RAXML analysis. And the phylogeny supports the monophyly of the genus Selvasaura and supports the monophyly of the new species. And the new species is a sister from Ecuador, is a sister clade of a clade confirmed by a species from Colombia and another one from Peru. And also the phylogeny show that the sister clade of Selvasaura is a clade conformed by Potamites and Dendrosauridium, and all these three taxa, Selvasaura, Potamites, and Dendrosauridium, are example of a cis-Andean radiation of Cercosaurine lizards. In this case, we also prepared the hemipenes of this species, and we found that they are unilobed. So if we compare with Folidobulus, the hemipenes in Folidobulus were bilobed, and in this case, they are unilobed. And unilobed hemipenes have been reported only few species in Gymnophthalmidae, but in different subfamilies. So this could be an important trait to identify these species in museum collections. Something remarkable about this study was that we did a detailed description of the cranial osteology of this species, and even the great diversity of gymnophthalmid lizards and the availability of museum collections. The cranial osteology has been described in detail for a handful of species. One of those species is Potamites. So what we did is that we compared the skull of Selvasaura with the Potamites, and we found that they share some traits, such as the nasals are separated by a process of premaxilla, and also that the frontal is narrow and has a trifurcate anterior margin. However, it's hard to do comparative studies in this case because there is not a lot of information. So the lack of information for major taxa precludes a better understanding of the cranial evolution in gymnophthalmid lizards and in Cercosaurines. So the conclusions of the study was that we recognized four new species for the genus Polydobulus and one new species for the genus Selvasaura. And all the discoveries of these new species highlight the importance of further sampling across the Andean region, as well as the building of localized approach to promote conservation and land management in Ecuador. So my plan for my coming years doing my PhD is to keep working on this great family. It really has a great diversity, morphological and ecological variation. So my plan is work on phylogenomics to better understand the evolution of this important family, and also generate genomic data to do comparative genomics to study convergent evolution and also the evolution of interesting traits such as limbless or body elongation. And thank you all for your attention. And I want to thank my previous university in Ecuador and also my current university here in the United States. And I'm happy to take your questions.
Excellent talk. If anyone has any questions for our second speaker, at this point, you are welcome to raise a hand and I will invite you to unmute so you can ask that question verbally. If you're feeling a little bit shy, you are certainly welcome to put your questions for our speaker in the chat where they can be answered. All right, excellent. It looks like Karen has a question.
Well, my question is fairly simple. I'm just wondering whether you have specific locations you're hoping to check out for future studying.
Yeah, well, the ideal scenario is to sample everything, like Central and South America. But for now, I'm just collecting data from Ecuador, but then I'm moving to other countries in South America.
Nice.
Excellent. Well, that is 7:45, so we have to move on. So again, thank you for your talk.
Thank you.
And I believe we have Dr. Yi next. Perfect, we can see that.
Yeah, hi, can you see my slide?
Yes, yes, we can.
Okay, great. All right, can I start now or is there?
Yes, go right ahead.
Okay, perfect, thanks. Thanks for coming to my talk. My name is Ling. I'm currently a postdoc at the University of Hong Kong. Today, I'm going to present part of my PhD research when I did at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee in the United States. So the study is about the systematics of the New World bats, Aptesicus and Histiotus, and the indication of a transmarine dispersal. So basically, there are two theories to explain how some lineages got broadly distributed around the globe. First is the vicariance theory, which predicts that organisms that lived on one big landmass was carried over to different continents during tectonic movements. However, this theory only fits the animals or plants that lived during that time, such as dinosaurs, which lived around over 100 million years ago. For animals or plants that diverged more recently, such as most of the mammals, they more likely move around continents via dispersal. For example, this is the proposed colonization route of human beings from Old World to the New World. And we can see that there are two important land connections, one in the north, the Beringia, and the other between North and South America. So this is the first hypothesis that organisms move between continents by on-land dispersal. However, this is not the only way to move between separated continents. The alternative is transmarine dispersal. For example, this review summarizes a few studies that suggested transmarine dispersal. And if we focus on the Atlantic, there are cases proposed in lizards, mammals, and angiosperms, and those organisms can drift or raft or even fly across the ocean to colonize different continents, especially if there is hurricane or strong oceanic currents. However, despite the accumulating evidence, the alternative transmarine dispersal remains underrepresented in the literature. So here in my study, I was focused on the bats and I was interested to learn their mechanisms of global distribution and diversification. So in particular, I focus on the genus Aptesicus. Here, this phylogeny is the family Vespertilionidae, and the red square highlights the genus Aptesicus, which is zoomed in on the right. This genus includes species from the Old World, New World in North America, and a few species in South America. And interestingly, some species having large ears were historically identified as a unique genus called Histiotus, but molecular studies repeatedly showed that they cluster within the genus Aptesicus, so in this study, I will consider them together. And my first hypothesis is that the Aptesicus species moved via land bridge from Old World to the New World. So the mitochondrial phylogeny from previous studies kind of support this hypothesis by showing that Aptesicus fossils from North America diverged first in the New World. So these New World species likely have a North American origin. Alternatively, nuclear genes showed a different topology where the South American Histiotus diverged first and indicated a South American origin. In that case, it's the alternative transmarine dispersal from Africa to South America. And another topology, if the new tropical Aptesicus diverged first, then again, it's the South American origin and a transmarine dispersal. So I collected samples representing both New World and Old World species and collected multi-locus data to reconstruct the more complete phylogeny to test these two hypotheses. I included 96 samples from museums and collected from museums and researchers. In this phylogeny, the red dots represent roughly the position of my outgroup species, and the red square is the in-group species Aptesicus. I included samples from both the Old World and New World, and I had more biogeographic sampling from the New World to capture potentially cryptic species. To build the phylogeny, I used the ultra-conserved elements. For this study, I just used a previously designed bait, including 5,000 UC loci for tetrapods. And the same bait has been used in another study for bats in the genus Myotis. So I was able to incorporate some of their samples, including two Myotis species and two individuals of Aptiascus foscus. Then these samples were processed by phylogeny and I filtered based on the number of loci and missing data. And in the end, I retained 84 individuals and over 3,600 UC loci. So first I constructed a maximum likelihood tree where we can see that there are four major clades in the New World. First is the Aptiascus foscus in North America, and then Histiotus in South America, and two differentiated clades of Neotropical Aptiascus. Then based on this maximum likelihood tree, I grouped individuals into 54 operational taxonomic units that could represent species or subspecies or biogeographic lineages. And based on the 54 OTUs, I constructed species trees using three different methods, including the summary method, ASTRAL, the SVD quartets, and the Bayesian method, BPP. The three methods showed highly similar topologies, except for a few lineages that are closely related that have discordant positions, possibly reflecting incomplete lineage sorting or recent gene flow among those lineages. And interestingly, the Old World Aptiascus were found paraphyletic in all topologies except for the BPP tree, which showed monophyly. Then in the Old World, again, we showed four major clades, including two sister clades of Neotropical Aptiascus, the clade of Histiotus, and its sister clade Aptiascus foscus in North America. So then I fixed the ASTRAL tree to estimate their divergence time using the program MCMC tree. I included two soft-bounded time calibrations around the root nodes based on previous studies. And the results showed that the New World clades diverged around 15 to 17 million years ago, which roughly corresponds to the mid-Miocene climate optimum. And therefore, these data suggested that the historical climate change might have triggered long-distance dispersal and subsequent diversification of these bat species. Then, based on this time phylogeny, I reconstructed ancestral distribution using the program BioGeoBears. So the zoo geographic areas are color-coded on the map. And in this tree, the pie charts at the nodes represent probabilities of each geographic area for the ancestral distribution. So we found that the common ancestor of all Aptiascus species most likely originated from North Africa, and the common ancestor of all New World species most likely originated from Northern Neotropics. Therefore, these data suggest that a colonization route from Northern Africa to Northern Neotropics, and therefore support the transmarine or transatlantic dispersal for these bat species. And interestingly, we showed for the first time that the South American Histiotus species are more closely related to the Aptiascus foscus instead of their sympatric Neotropical Aptiascus. In addition, we showed that there probably is still underestimated diversity of these bats in South America. So for example, this is the Histiotus clade in the ASTRAL species tree. A specimen that was unidentified when I collected them was later described as a new species called Histiotus mochica. And then two specimens labeled as Histiotus valetus collected from museums were actually sampled from different areas and seemed to have different morphologies, and they were supported to be different lineages, even species, based on the molecular tree. Similar things happened with another species described as Aptiascus brasiliensis. These species were collected from different areas, and they were split into the two well-differentiated clades of the Neotropical Aptiascus. So this data suggests that the samples, the individuals described as Aptiascus brasiliensis, still includes cryptic species that needs to be described. So together, our results suggested that we need a reevaluation of these bats, especially in South America, of reevaluation of the taxonomy of these bats from South America, and not only based on morphology and genetics, but hopefully also based on their ecology and life history traits. So I'm still interested in this research and I'm keep doing related studies. So if you're interested to collaborate, please let me know. With that, I would like to thank the museums and researchers who generously supported my study by sharing their samples with me. And I would like to thank my lab mates at UWM, my PhD committee members, the UWM IT group, and the UWM grad school for the fundings. And if you have further questions, please feel free to reach out, and I would like to chat about that. So with that, thank you for listening, and I'm happy to take any questions.
All right. Thank you for that wonderful talk. At this time, anyone who has any questions is now welcome to use the raised hand reaction to be called on to ask their question verbally, or if you're feeling a little shy, you can put your question in the chat box. No one's jumping at the chance. I'm actually a little bit curious. So when it comes, I know bat phylogeny is really contentious, not just in this group, but across a lot of them. I was curious how much is known about the divergence ages, both in this group and across bats. And I guess, is this a young group of bats relative to other bats, or is this a fairly old one? What does that look like?
I see. So most of the bats diverged after, the KTG boundary. So for this particular genus, I wouldn't say that it's very old. And we probably don't really know, very detailed time of their divergence. So when I did time estimation, it's actually the confidence interval is kind of large. So we don't know exactly when they diverge. We just have a rough estimation. But the time during Miocene, especially mid-Miocene, is kind of a time for, speciation for a lot of groups. So a lot of divergence happened during that time. And I believe it's, speciation is still ongoing. Sorry, I don't have a really specific answer to your question. I think it's a little bit hard to say whether they're young or old. But thanks.
I thought that might be the answer. we have a raised hand from Sonali. If you'd like to unmute, I need to unmute you. Sorry, that one's my fault. There you are.
Hi, Ling. Great talk. I just have a question. Please pardon my ignorance. What is the distance that these bats are known to fly? You're suggesting transoceanic dispersal. How far can bats fly? And a related question, when do you suggest, when you suggest these events to have occurred, how close were these land masses historically?
Good question. Thank you. First question about how long they can fly. So about South American bats, we have very little understanding about their ecology and life history traits. So I don't really know specifically the distance they can fly. But for North American, Aptiscus foscus, they distribute around the continent in North America. So presumably they are able to fly long distance because it's one currently recognized one species in North America, so they can, fly long distance across the continent. And then for the historical time when they might have taken this cross ocean trip, the distance between South America and Africa is similar to the current distance. It's during mid-Miocene, it's already after the separation of two continents. So it looks like a long distance dispersal. But one thing we mentioned to support our hypothesis is that these bats they can fly in groups, so it's their swarming behavior, and the females can store sperm. And when they fly, especially when there is strong hurricane or strong winds, it's very easy to just blow them off the continent. So if you think about Caribbean islands, a lot of bats probably just blown off from North America to those islands. So it's not totally unlikely, although it probably is a little bit difficult to imagine for human beings. But we think it's likely some kind of an evolutionary coincidence that happened, and you know, they were able to travel long this distance and move to from Africa to South America. Yeah, that's our current hypothesis. It's suspicion, but the data kind of support this hypothesis. Thanks.
Excellent. So we are about out of time. You do have two questions in the chat if you'd like to answer those kind of.
Yeah, sure. I can type in the chat.
Yes, perfect. Thank you. It looks like Emil, are you ready to go?
Yeah, I am.
Perfect. You want to go ahead and try your screen share before I blink off? I will give you a thumbs up if everything's running all right.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Oh, yeah. Is that fine?
There we go. That is perfect. All right. Cool. And you are good to go.
Yeah, thank you. So hi, everyone. This is Umayal, and you can call me Uma from Griffith University, Australia. So I'm doing my postdoc as well as tutoring in Griffith University in Brisbane, Australia. So today I'm just going to take you through one of my software, which I have designed along with my supervisor, Shankar Subramaniam, PhD supervisor, Shankar Subramaniam, from when I was in my master's. So that's VCF to PopTree. And title of the software is it's mainly for a client-side software to construct population phylogeny from genome-wide SNPs. And since the phylogeny is a representation of the evolutionary history and relationship between group of organisms, building a simplified software is always essential in the field. So phylogeny can be built via using different data inputs, as we know. So it can be divided into multiple categories. So the first one is using the gene sequences, like either it could be like one gene sequence or multiple gene sequence, like the phylogeny could be calculated, it could be determined and then constructed. And then with the other one, like it is using a genomes. So using the genomic sequences, like it can be constructed. And then the third one is using the VCF data. So using the single nucleotide polymorphisms, the phylogenetic tree, the estimation can be calculated, and then the phylogenetic tree can be constructed. So today, let's have a quick look at some of the example software and the advantage of each input type and the available software, which is already there. So the first one, as we know, it's using the genetic sequence, gene sequences. So the software, the existing software which is available that reads the sequences, the genetic sequences from one or few genes or multiple genes and produces the output. And commonly, it's been found that the output will be constructed in the form of a nuke tree or in the graphical format. And majority of the applications, those are the standalone, and it needs to be installed on the computer. So, that's the main thing. And then the example softwares are for these ones are the POP and Phylip and Mega and Beast. So the next one, the next type of input, giving an input is using the genome sequences. So, since we give the sequences through the whole genomes, it predominantly used for the interspecies phylogeny. So, for example, the software such as RaxML, XML, and MPSC, Arialfi. So, the multiple softwares could be used for the interspecies phylogeny, for constructing the interspecies phylogeny. And then these are the standalone application which has to be installed onto the computers, or it can be accessed either through the servers, through the cloud. And the third type is using the VCF data, as the phylogenetic tree could be created. So there are many softwares like which constructs the phylogeny using the VCF data. So the first one, some of them are mentioned over here, which is the SNP Phylo, VCF Kit, and VCF to Tree, PhyloSNP and SNPRelate. So these gets the genotype using the genotypes in the genomes, from the genomes in the VCF file. It will be able to access the data and consolidate it and then creates the phylogenetic tree. And there are many software which are standalone applications, and also it can be run using the R script. So these days there are several set of R script oriented programs available. So This is just one of them. So, and another main thing is these VCF data, the whole genome VCF data, that can be accessed through this online server-based software, and then the data which has to be uploaded in there. And the examples for them are the major examples for the whole genome data using the VCF data is the SNPlay and CSI Phylogeny, and then the Galaxy software. So that's been, the Galaxy is widely been used. So here in my presentation, I'm just gonna use that for the comparison with the VCF to POP tree. So the limitations overall, we've seen the three types of the software. So overall, like the main limitation, the major limitation which we found was many of the softwares needs the installation process. That is a specific set of installation process which has to be, the software has to be installed. And if it is not a standalone, then it needs some other the packages for support for the program to be run, and then the genomic data to be uploaded to the server, and also it involves a series of data processing steps, and computationally it is more intensive and time consuming. So since some of the softwares are on server, working on server or on the cloud, so when multiple people access them, like there is a lot of web traffic happening, and then the internet speed should be high for the user. So, and also mainly it requires, certain level of expertise in the computers in common. So the standalone application. So these softwares can work as a standalone application. And then these are the web-based software, online software. And also, as we mentioned, like it can be accessed through the R scripts as well. So our VCF to POP tree, this has been the previous limitations has been overcome by our software. So this requires only the browser, and there is no need for the installations, and it reads files from the local computer itself, because since it is a client-side software, we don't have to include utilize it from the server or through the standalone process. So it is just with the single script. So it can read the files from the local computers, and there is no big data processing. So, and also the speed, it is super fast with the speed. So it takes like seconds to minutes to read 1 GB of data and to construct a tree. And it does not require expertise in computers as well. So since this is a client-side software, it has been developed by using the JavaScript, HTML, and CSS, so the basic languages for constructing the tree. We have used this d3.js. And then it reads the zip file as well in order to add on. And then it draws the tree straight from the browser. And it produces the output in the form of a pairwise distance matrix, Newark tree, which can be used by Mega or other programs, such as like FigTree and then Mega. And then it is compatible with all other popular browsers and also the operating systems. So the target user for this software, which we've created, is the VCF to POP tree. The researchers from the field of genetics, ecology, and evolution, the biologists with a little or no expertise in installing and running the computer programs, and anyone who wants to have a quick look at the phylogenetic relationship of the population genetic genome data from the large VCF file. And here we go. So this is our VCF to POP tree main page. So we have got some of the features up here. So this is the main page for the VCF to POP tree. So initially, when you have a look at the left side of the slide, so you can able to see this compressed VCF file. So we can choose the option. We can give the input either by using the compressed format of VCF data or by using the direct VCF data. So we can even mention the minimum quality score. If you want to restrict it to minimum quality score, you can restrict it. And then the coverage depth, so that can be restricted as well. Likewise, all other functions are mentioned below. So these are all the ones which is by default. These are all being chosen by default. And then initially the distance and missing data and model has been calculated along with the size of the whole genome or chromosome pairs input. And then the second set of instruction in order to construct the tree and show the display the output format. So the new the output can be displayed in UIC and pairwise as mentioned, and also the population genetics analysis that we're using the stats. And you can select the genomes as well. So these are the main features for our software. And then initially to start with one of the outputs of the UPG using the UPGMA tree. So that's this. So using 10 genomes from different backgrounds. So, you know, this tree has been constructed using the UPGMA algorithm. And there is also the radial tree options available, which can be built. And the third one is using the selected genomes. You can select any number of genomes that you want from the VCF data which has been given. So out of 10 genomes, I have chosen only 5. So using this text field, you can just choose as many number of genomes you want, but the minimum number is 4. And then fourth one is the UIC tree file format. So the file structure can be created in the UIC tree format using the software, which has been mentioned below, and based on the VCF file, which has been uploaded. And then the pairwise distance matrix that has been calculated and then uploaded in the form of, the results will be shown in the format of Mega. So because Mega is widely used, and then, users can able to, clients can be able to use this software, and then they can simply copy this one and then paste it in Mega in order to get whatever the required interactive tree construction they would like, and also in any other formats. So right, currently it supports just Mega. And then that's all about the outputs. And then in order to look at the performance of the VCF to POP tree, we have compared it with one of the online server-based software. So that is Galaxy. So initially, the one which you can see on the red, that's the Galaxy performance. And then the one which is on the blue, that's the VCF to POP tree performance. So the number of SNPs, the graph shows this number of SNPs versus the execution time. And the execution time is something which reads the input file, VCF file, to produce and construct the phylogenetic tree. And then the VCF to POP tree, comparatively, if you can able to look at, like, it just puts a faster compared to the Galaxy. And for around like 400,000 SNPs, VCF to POP tree took just 5 seconds, while it took 3 minutes for Galaxy. And for 4 million SNPs, when we inputted the 4 million SNPs to the VCF to POP tree, the time taken was 20 seconds, but in Galaxy, it was 8 minutes. And then in order to compare the performance of the genomes, number of genomes, this is the executive time, we've analyzed the time it took. So the VCF to POP tree was at least like 7 times faster than the Galaxy, according to the analyzation. So the VCF to POP tree also processed like 400,000 SNPs from 10 genomes in just 5 seconds, but in the Galaxy, it's 3 minutes it took. And then for 100 genomes, which contains around like 2 million SNPs, the processing times were 3.5 to 30 minutes, and for Galaxy, it is 30 minutes, respectively. So the VCF to POP tree, in order to use the Galaxy, you have to get the account to be created. And then it has to be, VCF just has to be, it has to be uploaded to the server. And there are series of steps which has to be processed before we reach the VCF tree. However, the VCF to POP tree draws the tree in just 2 clicks. It is super fast. And the availability of the VCF to POP tree software, like, it can be available through the GitHub. So, there's the zip file, which contains the HTML file, and then the sample test file and the documentation. So it can be cited through the, Subramanian et al. 2019 through the PLG. So the limitation of VCF to POP3 is like maximum number of genomes which is acceptable is 1,500 genomes. And then there is no limit for the files and no limit for the numbers as is number of SNPs as well. It depends on the computer's memory. So we have tested it with the standard computer memory, which is by using the 8 GB RAM and i5 processor. And we've got all the performance analyzed, which has been discussed. And then there are current additions which has been going on. So here, if you can see the ones in the blue font, so those are the ones which has been adding. So missing genotype and then base quality and depth of coverage can be chosen by the user along with the population genetic analysis. additional population genetic analysis. And I'm so thankful to Dr. Shankar Subramaniam, who's my PhD supervisor, and Dr. Chen, collaborator from Griffith University, and ARC for funding the research, and Griffith University and Sunshine University of the Sunshine Coast. Yeah, thank you. Any other questions?
Right on time. Unfortunately, we don't have time for questions. That is the end of our session.